Round of applause.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. So my name is Frank Karliczek. I'm an open source and free software developer for a long, long, long time. I think close to 20 years. Yes, I'm officially old. I'm involved in all kinds of different open source projects. For example, the KDE project I worked with for a long, long time. Was a board member there for a while. But I think nowadays I'm mostly well known for as being the founder of OwnCloud and also being the founder of Nextcloud, the successor of it. So I want to talk a little bit about the current problems with centralized services, internet services that we see, and then a little bit about potential solutions for that, which is like having everything distributed and federated. A little bit about Nextcloud, don't want to talk about it too much here, but some ideas of what we are doing to solve these problems. And then hopefully at the end we still have time for some question and answers, which in my opinion is always the most fun part. Okay, so this you've all seen this, right? This is this beautiful poster that is all standing around here on the outside. I actually took this photo this morning here because I find it actually quite interesting, especially for this talk here. Interesting because of a few things. First of all, you have here, let me see if this works. Not really. Doesn't work, whatever. You see here, it's doing strange things. No, what's happening? Okay, so I can describe it. See, in the middle you see that the topic is artificial intelligence, machine learning, and personal assistance. I saw this morning lots of talks in this area, especially personal assistance, which I personally find very interesting, and also a lot of discussions and talks about cloud. So a lot about this personal assistant things like the Amazon Echo that you all know probably, Google Assistant, and Apple Siri and other devices like that. Another thing you notice on this poster is, on the very top, FOSS, Free and Open Source Software. This is an open source conference that we are here, which is already interesting because most of the services that I mentioned earlier are actually not open source. So Amazon is not open source, Google Assistant is not open source, Apple Siri is not open source, and so on, which I find already quite interesting here, that we have a topic here which unfortunately is dominated by not open source solutions. Another thing you see here on this poster is Asia. Obviously, we are in Asia here, which is a little bit different than most of these cloud service backends, because all these services that these devices are talking to are actually run by US companies somewhere else, not here. So I find this already quite interesting as a poster, because it quite nicely demonstrates the challenge that we all have here as an open source community. So this is all getting more centralized. All these services are getting more centralized. All the Amazon Echo is talking to the centralized Amazon services, Google is talking to the Google services, and so on, which is quite interesting because the internet actually started in a decentralized way. So the internet started completely federated and decentralized. So what does this mean? If you look at the Wikipedia definition of it, it says that the internet is a global system of interconnected computer networks. So the internet by itself, by nature, is a distributed and federated medium. It's not centralized. So what exactly do I mean when I say centralized? What I mean with centralized is there is no central instance. Right? So there's no central internet server. There's no central company which manages the whole internet. There's no central instance. It's always possible to have different providers. So if, for example, get your email from one provider, you can get your chat service from another provider, and your website is hosted somewhere else, and you can also choose between them. So you can say, I don't like this internet provider anymore, this internet service provider or the email provider anymore, I switch to a different one, and it still works. And this is possible because there is different server software and different client software available. If you look at FTP, or the web itself, or email again, or XMPP as chat, so there's all kinds of different, mostly open source server software and client software available. So and you can host it wherever you want. You don't have to go to a central internet company which somehow manages your central messaging service. It's really distributed and federated. And of course, mostly open source and free software. Examples for this decentralized internet services are mail again. And let me explain a little bit more what I mean with that. It is possible that I have my own mail server at home, or my company has a mail server, or my university has a mail server, or someone goes to Yahoo or Gmail for their mail services. So it's possible to have different mail services, but the thing is that we can all send each other email. Right? I can send a mail from my personal company mail account to an account that's hosted by Gmail, for example. And this is all possible because there are open standards involved, SMTP, to send emails around. There is no central email company. It's not needed, but it still works. Other examples are Usenet, news groups, not very much used anymore, unfortunately, but also very distributed and federated service, ISE, as a very, very early, very good chat protocol, also distributed. The web itself, right? The web itself is fully distributed and federated. There is no central company, some company which manages like the central website of the world and everybody has to be linked from there. This doesn't exist. Everybody can run a web server. And XMPP, of course, as a chat protocol. Okay, this is all great. This is the nature of the internet, as I said. Unfortunately, if you look at newer services, they tend to be more centralized, which is a problem. Examples are file sync and share, like Google Drive or Dropbox or OneDrive, very centralized. Everybody's uploading all their files to this one central service. Social networking, there's Facebook and Twitter and a few others, but you can't really host it yourself. It's not open source. You can't really run your own Facebook at home, Facebook server. It's not possible. Video voice communication, a lot is done by Hangouts and Skype and other services, so it's not really federated. Messengers, right? We all use these messengers on our mobile phones, which are really completely locked down to a central instance, not open at all, not a software, not a protocol. And then this whole area of artificial intelligence or personal assistance, as I mentioned earlier, this is really like you buy a device, or it's included in your device, it's included in your television, for example, or in your smartwatch, and it all only talks to this one service. You can't say, okay, television, can I please then do my personal assistant thing with my own server over there? That's not possible. And automotive, right, this whole area with self-driving cars. Cars are really like big computers on four wheels nowadays. There's a lot of calculation and communication going on. They only talk to their own cloud backends. So this is all very centralized. You might say, okay, why not? This works well. What's the problem? Well, there are a few problems with that. First of all, this is all proprietary software. And we are an open source conference here. So this is already the first issue here. Because we care about open source, because we can look into the code, because we can change it, we can study it, we can improve it. All not possible. All not possible with all these services I mentioned. Cost is a problem. You might say, what do you mean? My Dropbox account is free. Well, if we start to use it more and more, and at one time we have all our files uploaded there, it's no longer for free. And if there's a monopoly, then there's the danger of increasing the prices, of course. Speed, you might say, I don't know, I never had a problem with synchronizing my Word file. Well, if you have a lot of data, then the centralized services are actually a problem. One of our users is, for example, CERN, the research institution in Switzerland. They deal with petabytes of data. if you would tell them, hey, if you have to upload all your petabytes of data to a hosting center on the other side of the world, only so that your colleagues can see it, doesn't really make sense. Legal issues. So basically, if you're in a country outside the United States where most of these services run, then you have interesting legal issues. Also, questions about how independent is a country still. I mean, if a country would totally depend on a different country for water supply or for electricity, everybody would say, well, that's a problem. But if we completely depend on a different country for all our IT needs in the future, that's interesting. And last but not least, no ownership of the data. So most of the terms of services actually say if you upload your data there, they have some rights. It depends which service you use. But for most of them, you give up some rights over your own data only because you want to synchronize it. That's not good. So what can we do? What can we do? Well, first of all, first step is quite obvious. We are an open source conference here. Let's write an open source alternative. Let's write an open source alternative for cloud services. And there are some examples for file sync and share. There's H Explorer, there's OwnCloud, Nextcloud, Cozy Cloud, Cfile, and so on. And then no problem, then you have your own self-hosted alternative to these cloud services. Then you have your own personal Dropbox, for example, for your friends and family. But you can already see with this picture here what the problem might be. Because now you have like not one central service, but you have lots of these small islands. And I have my local Nextcloud at home, my company has a Nextcloud at home, my university has a Nextcloud, my parents use some Nextcloud somewhere else, and we all are very secure, but also very isolated. That's also not a solution. Okay? So what can we do? We invented a concept of federation, which works very similar to what I mentioned earlier with email. So the idea is that you can have your own, all your different instances, but they can actually communicate with each other. So in the same way, when I have my mail server at home, or my mail server in my university, and I can still send the mail to Gmail, in the same way, you can here share your files between instances. So let's say this one instance is mine at home, which is like just a small Raspberry Pi, and this other one is an instance at my company. We can still have a sharing link, so we can still have like a shared folder. Every time I upload something in this one shared folder, it automatically pops up on this shared folder on the other side. So it behaves as one big instance, the same way email behaves as one big messaging system, but it's actually completely federated. So that's great. So here's an example from from Nextcloud, a screenshot. As you can see here in the middle, you have all your files there. In this example, here's some photos. If you click on a photo, you see this sidebar here. And here in the sidebar, you can type in a username. You can say, I want to share this photo with this user. And what you can do then is also you can type in the ID of a remote user. So in the same way, you can type in an email address, which is a username, then an @ symbol, and then a host name. You can type in a username, @, and then a different Nextcloud server. And this way, my Nextcloud server communicates with other Nextcloud server and say, hey, here's a shared file. And this other user gets a pop-up. Do you want to accept it or not? And then you have this file shared between different servers. So this is great. This is basically implemented the same system that exists for email, basically. Okay? So everything done, everything implemented, everything awesome. So victory, right? So we have saved the internet. Everything is distributed and federated now. Great. No one is using Dropbox anymore. Obviously not, because this is a lot better. It's open source and self-host, it's awesome, so we have won. Well, not really, I think. Because obviously, still everybody's using Facebook, everybody's using Google Drive, and so on. No one is using these self-hosted services. So why is that? Let's look at a few examples. Everybody, someone knows Diaspora here? Okay, some people do. So Diaspora was an idea to build like an open source, self-hosted, federated Facebook. It's basically in the same way Nextcloud is a self-hosted, federated Dropbox or Google Drive replacement. So you can take Diaspora, run it in your company, a university somewhere, and it talks to other instances, and it's fully federated, which is great. Well, and there's this other thing, this totally legacy product called Facebook, no one is using it, right? Well, obviously Facebook has won and Diaspora not so much. So why is that? I don't know. Then there's XMPP. XMPP is a nice chat standard, fully distributed, federated, encrypted, supports all kinds of communication methods, really nice. But there's like the apps like WhatsApp, which somehow have won, are more popular. They're not open source, they're totally centralized, they have evil terms of service, still everybody's using it. I don't know why. Well then, there's Identica, it's the same way as this distributed, federated Twitter alternative, so still everybody's using Twitter. You get the idea, right? So Akiga is like a also self-hosted Skype alternative, everybody is using Skype, and so on and so on. So obviously, we haven't won yet. So everybody's using centralized services, not so good. What can we do? So why didn't this work? So what's the problem? Why didn't this work? So we as an open source community, we sort of failed, right? We built like great software, but everybody's using proprietary software somewhere else. So someone has any idea why we failed with that? Yeah. Reliability? Yeah. Sorry? Trust. Yeah, trust. Very good. Yes. Some other idea? Yeah. Complexity to set up, complexity to host, yes. No, you need to know what you're doing. Yes. Someone else? What do you mean with that? Sorry? Lack of funding? Yeah, okay. Lots of good points. It's really hard to say what we need to do to bring our open source project basically to the next level. A few things, some of them mentioned already. Making self-hosting super easy. So as discussed, like making it really easy to have your own instance. Because at the moment it's just easier to go to Dropbox and create an account than to have like a Nextcloud instance. Finding people is something which is usually very hard. So this is a problem if you share with other people, then you're on your own instance and maybe you have created like an account for your parents and your dog and your friends and that's it, but the rest of the world you can't find. Of course you can type in the ID if you know it, but usually you don't know it. So how can I actually find people to collaborate and to communicate with them? I think we as open source project also has to collaborate more with each other. There are lots of projects that want to solve this federation problem. Have to work together. We have to think outside the box and innovate. Just building something that exists somewhere else, just do a copy of Facebook, just do a copy of Twitter, is not good enough. So we have to make a better one. That's key. And we have to innovate. We have to think about the future. Now I want to talk a little bit about some examples, what we are doing at Nextcloud. I'm not saying that we have the solution here, because we don't have the solution, but some ideas how this could work, in our opinion. First of all, self-hosting. How can I get Nextcloud? Well, we want to provide all kinds of different ways to get your own Nextcloud server. First of all, there are devices like the one on top, just like nicely pre-configured boxes that you can buy, you could put into your company or at home, and then you have your own little server. So this is something we do. One is called a Spreed box, the other is called the Nextcloud box. Second is we package it and make it available for all kinds of Linux distributions here. So just with a simple install, or also as a Docker container if you prefer that. So make it really easy and super fast to set up your own server. And then the third option is, of course, is what I have here with this hosting center. There are also a lot of service providers who offer this already. So if you go to our website, nextcloud.com/providers, then you see like over 20 service providers who offer this already. So you can go there and use it. Okay, great. Now I have my own little Nextcloud. What do I do next? Okay, let's go through like a real world use case here. Let's say I'm on vacation and I take some photos and I want to share these photos with my friends. Very common use case. Okay, first I take some photos with my phone or with my DSLR and upload it to my desktop, whatever. Then the next thing you have to do, you have to upload it to your Nextcloud server. Here are some screenshots on the left. There's our iOS app. On the right, this is a desktop app for Mac, Windows, and Linux, also available for Android, it's also a dedicated app, which automatically, in the background, with automatic photo upload, can upload it to your server. So this is super easy, it just happens automatically. You need to set up it once, just a few simple steps, and that's it, and then all your files are automatically uploaded, not to the Google Cloud, not to the Apple Cloud, but to your own Nextcloud server. Okay, great. So now I have here on my Nextcloud, I have my nice vacation pictures all here, all visible. That's nice, but that's only for me. Obviously, I want to share them with my friends. So what can I do? Well, here on top, you have the share menu, and you can click on it, and then you get this nice pop-up here, and then you can see already a few friends that you worked with and that you shared with in the past. You can just click on them and say, okay, share my vacation pictures. Or on the top, there's also search contacts. There's an input line. And the key here is that I want to type in any name, even names on remote servers, even people on different servers. And I want to be able to find my friends even if they have their Nextcloud account on a different service provider, self-hosted somewhere else, have a different box, or whatever. And this is actually what we want to make possible, or what we implemented already. So in this search field, you can actually find people from all over the world, even if they're not on the same machine. And you can also, by the way, do more than sharing. If you click on this dot menu, you can also call the people, and email the people, chat with the people, and so on. So it's more about all about communication and not only about sharing. Okay, how does this actually work? How can I find people on other servers? How can I find people on different Nextcloud servers? Well, this is an example here of my personal page on my Nextcloud server. And as you can see here, in all these input lines, you have these small lock icons here. And if you click on them, here in the example with address, you can decide that, okay, my address is only private, only visible for me, or it is visible for all my contacts. So people in my address book should be able to see and find me by address. Or you can say, visible for public. And if you select public, then this record is automatically uploaded to a lookup server where it can be found by other people. And this is something which works a bit similar than GPG key servers that some of you might know. GPG has the same problem that you have to exchange the public keys to work together. And optionally, you can upload your public key to this key server and then you can actually be found. We implemented the same concept here. So you have this lookup server, which does master-master replication. So it's not only we run one instance, but it's also run by other people, and it's replicated around. And you can then find other people. In the future, we move to a distributed hash table there, which we don't have at the moment. But this is the next step. And I'm also a member of W3C as an invited expert, and we work together with them to make this a standard. So the idea is that you have federated services, but you have the same user experience than with Google and Facebook, where you can just type in any name and you can find anyone. You do the same without a central server. Okay, and then I basically have shared this with someone. Another feature we have here is that on this sidebar, you can also comment. For example, on my vacation pictures, you will also want to have comments from your friends and family. And the interesting thing is that you have all these avatar pictures with names, and you can also click on them. And they can say, okay, here this user here who commented on that, I want to call this person, or email, or chat with this person, and so on. And this is all integrated into Nextcloud. So if you, for example, click on chat, then this nice window here opens on the bottom of the screen. So we have a full XMPP chat integrated, so which is also fully federated, by the way. That users don't have to be on the same server, and you can chat with them automatically, fully encrypted, of course, about these files that you shared. Another thing you can do is you can click on call, and then a window opens here, which, by the way, this is actually not yet available. So this window is only full screen, not on the bottom of the screen. But what we have is a fully implemented WebRTC video calling, video voice calling integrated. So if you want to do a call around your files that you shared, you can directly talk with the people in the right context. And again, 100% open source, 100% self-hosted. All the video calling is done peer-to-peer. It's fully peer-to-peer and fully encrypted, of course. So most of these other services, if you read that Signal, for example, now supports video calling and it's encrypted and so on, and same with other services, it's all nice, but they all go through the central server, so they all collect all the metadata. They all know who talks to whom, when, why, what. In this case, this is fully federated and self-hosted, of course. And of course, you can also do like bigger video calls with a bigger group of people if you want to. Okay, so now I'm done with my presentation. I want to have this last slide with the summary. I think what we want to have is a fully federated and secure and self-hosted internet infrastructure around sharing of files and around communication. Email, chat, video, voice, sharing of files, and so on. It is super easy that everybody can do this. So the smallest instance of Nextcloud is running on a Raspberry Pi 2. This is this Nextcloud box, which costs like $30. The biggest installation we are doing is for 20 million users at the moment for a big service provider. And everything in between is also possible, obviously. So if you just want to run it in your company, your university, you can just go to our website, download the zip file. It's fully 100% open source. You can use it. Of course, you can also work with us, and then we can help you with setup and security and so on. It's really important that everything is distributed and federated on the internet going forward. I think this is really key. The trend to decentralized services, this is not a good one. This is like threatening the foundation of the internet, which is by design not centralized. Great UI and UX is really important. So it's really important that the service and the software that we're building here as open source community is really usable, looks nice, is easy to understand. Open protocols and standards, everything we have to do has to be open protocols and standard based, because there we can work together. It has to be open source and free software, obviously here. And I think we have to change the rules of the game here. So we can't just like re-implement something that exists somewhere else already. We have to really be innovative and move forward on doing good software, and then we can serve our goal. Okay, thanks a lot.
All right, we have time for a few questions.
Is there still time?
Yes, that's good. We have a few minutes for a few questions. Is there any questions out there in the audience? Yes, I see a few hands.
Hi. Here.
Yep.
Your left. Hi, I think this is massive, seriously. I mean, it's like open source web 2.0 if it works, and I think it could work. I mean, it looks, by the looks of it, I mean, maybe I tried and then it sucks when the user experience or whatever, but on the screens it looked amazing. My question is, what is the business models that you think can be created around this? Because obviously the hosting has to be paid by someone, right? I mean, you can't rely on people just like offering their internet connection to other people for free. So how do you envision that working?
Yeah. So maybe I should have said this in the very beginning. So I'm standing here with two hats on. So one hat is like the founder of the open source project. First OwnCloud, now NextCloud, as open source project. But of course, we also have a company around it, which employs most of the core volunteers. We have 25 people at the moment. And what we're doing as a company is that we are helping bigger companies, bigger organizations to host it and to run it and make it secure. And we also offer long-term service level agreements. So it's a bit like Red Hat. Like Red Hat, everything Red Hat is doing is open source. But you can get a subscription from them, which and makes sure that you have all the security patches and all the help, and you have the telephone hotline and so on available. And we do exactly the same for Nextcloud. So it's fully open source. You can download it if you want. If you run it in a critical, mission critical way in your company, then you probably want to talk with us, and we can help you doing this.
Okay, but that's your business model as developers of the software, right?
Yes.
But the business model for, because you talked about internet service providers hosting this already, right?
Yeah.
So how do they monetize that? I mean, what is their incentive to offer you the service? Or because then it's federated. I mean, it's like you host it somewhere, but anybody from anywhere else can actually access it, right? So
yeah, internet service providers, actually interesting. They come to us like really like crazy. They all come to us and say, okay, we want to offer this. We want to help our customers. We have customers, we have loyal customers for many, many years, and they want this kind of service. They don't want to create a different account by a different company in the US somewhere and move away. No, the service provider want to offer the products to the customers that the customers want. And they come to us and they want to use it. And most of them just download it and use it themselves, especially the smaller ones. And the bigger ones, they work with us to make it really good. But it's really, really popular. So we don't do any advertisement or anything, but like most of the big service providers, they already offer some kind of Nextcloud hosting.
Okay, thank you.
And we've run out of time. Thank you very much. A round of applause for Frank.